Imagine walking down the street and the trees illuminate your way. What if plants replace the solar panels on your roof? Living moss walls monitor and filter your air. And a greenhouse in your attic uses your gray water. I can already breathe better in this future. But why doesn't it exist? Well, time and time again, humans think we know better than nature. Let's focus locally for a minute. Salt Lake City has some of the worst air in the US. And in 2021, it was ranked number one in the world twice. And it'll continue to get worse as the Great Salt Lake dries. Beyond our local bubble, the lake drying will have widespread consequences across the hemisphere, manifesting in altered weather patterns to even complete collapse of entire ecosystems. To save the Great Salt Lake, people have discussed conservation. They've talked about cutting water to industries that use it the most. They've talked about building islands, building pipes that transport water from the ocean, or delivering it by train. And they've even suggested cutting down trees because too many trees might be sucking up too much water. Of all the solutions proposed, the most simple, plants, has yet to be considered. Take halophytes, for example. Halophytes are a type of plant that have adapted to live in high salt environments like the Great Salt Lake. They do an awesome job of stabilizing the soil and reducing evaporation, but the Great Salt Lake needs a little more help. Lily pads cover the surface water and reduce evaporation. Lily pads are not natural saltwater plants, but what if somehow we unlocked halophytes' natural ability to withstand high salinity? You may think of plants as simply food or aesthetics, but every plant has a superpower. And by unlocking that superpower, we can build the future I described. Some plants have even developed natural sunscreen by producing certain pigments known as flavonoids and anthocyanins, which act as UV filters, absorbing and reflecting harmful radiation. Others are capable of thermogenesis, which means they can generate their own heat, while other plants, like the lightning plant, can generate electricity. There are some plant species that have adapted to survive extreme dehydration, and others that can thrive in fire-prone environments and can even manipulate fire to their advantage. Some plants, like algae, exhibit bioluminescence and can glow in the dark. We've merely skimmed the surface when it comes to what we can learn from plants. Our best medicines are from plants. 40% of the drugs in the Western world come from plants, including the top 20 best-selling drugs in the US. Aspirin came from the willow bark, and vinca alkaloids, a drug used to stop cancer, was derived from the Madagascar periwinkle. Plants have been instrumental in our greatest discoveries and have furthered our understanding in major advancements in genetic science. If plants can do so much, then why aren't we utilizing them even more? One reason is that research is tough. I've experienced this firsthand when I worked in academia and biotech. Before I got into plants, projects I worked on were either shelved, abandoned, or funding would end before solutions are reached. And just like my lab, solutions for collecting plant data are slow, expensive, and not easily scalable. The truth is, we don't actually know that much about plants. There are nearly 400,000 plant species on this planet, and less than 10% has been studied. It currently takes, most of the information we do know is on the cash crops, corn and soy, and that information is owned by companies and largely inaccessible to the average person. It currently takes more than 15 years to develop a new crop seed, and approximately 50% of that research is abandoned. Funding for plant research is drying up. In the US, $65 billion goes into biotech, when only $1 billion goes into plants. And in the last 250 years, twice as many plants have gone extinct than birds, mammals, amphibians combined. Earlier, you helped me imagine a future that seemed only possible in science fiction, Imagine the world we could build once we unlock every plant's secret superpower. But if research is broken, then how can we do that? We could democratize research and take experiments outside of the lab and into your home so even you could be part of the solution. We're not going to replace labs or scientists, but that's not the goal. We discussed how solutions for collecting plant data are slow, expensive, and not easily scalable. By democratizing research, you fix that problem. You fast-track the hardest part of the process and make it easier for scientists to do the important work. How would this work? How can you and your plants contribute to science? You'd start with a piece of technology, a sensor you place in your plant's soil. That sensor would gather data in real time on moisture, temperature, humidity, light, soil salinity, nutrition, and even sound frequencies. So we can then begin to answer a plethora of unanswered questions. We just barely discover that plants make sounds, and we don't really know what the impact sound pollution is having on them. So imagine if that sensor was planted in thousands of plants in the city so we can compare it with the sensors in the countryside. And because the sensor is getting feedback directly from your plant, it'll make plant care easier and more accessible. With an app, you'll see exactly how much water each plant requires or the specific sunlight conditions it needs. And while you're contributing vital data to science, you also keep your plants alive longer and growing better. Now imagine, instead of a couple of scientists taking years to develop a new crop seed, we had hundreds or thousands of us with seeds in our garden, with sensors in our garden, and you're helping that scientist develop that seed in your garden. Or what if we understood the mechanisms of the plant that can dehydrate itself, or the plant that can manipulate fire? Because you contributed your data, we can apply it to your plant, and now your plant can grow anywhere. By taking care of your plants, you become a plant scientist for the world. Through democratizing research, we have made our greatest discoveries. When PlayStation 3 owners donated their console's processing power to scientific research, they created one of the largest supercomputers in the world. To do a comparable experiment at the time would have cost millions. Imagine trying to get funding for that. Their combined computing power helped researchers gain insights into Alzheimer's, Huntington's, cancer-related proteins, and even infectious diseases. Now, getting that data is only half the battle. The next limiting factor is me, the researcher. Because as scientists, we go in with a hypothesis and we're looking for a solution. And that often means I'm limited by my own biases and questions. Take another notable democratized experiment that turned protein folding into a game. Players were able to solve the structure of an AIDS-causing retrovirus enzyme that stumped scientists for more than a decade. Because to the player, it was just a game. They didn't have any preconceived ideas of what the answer should be. In fact, a lot of our best inventions are accidents, like Velcro, matches, penicillin. What we aim to do with democratized research is increase the incidence of accidents. Seems daunting, 400,000 plant species on this earth and less than 10% studied. So let's go back to Utah. Utah is home to nearly 4,000 plant species, and around 3,400 of them are indigenous, and 320 of them only occur in Utah. Of course, some of those plants won't be the kind you can have at home, but a lot of them, like the sunflower, you may already be growing. The sunflower has a ton of superpowers, from absorbing radiation, to being drought and heat tolerant, to even suppressing the growth of other plants. Young sunflowers exhibit something called heliotropism, which is a fancy way of saying their flower heads track the sun's movement across the sky. And we've already unlocked the superpower and have designed more efficient solar panels because of it. Imagine what we could do if we unlocked all of their superpowers. If we work together, the future I described becomes our reality. What superpowers could we unlock then? Could we accelerate plants, replacing plastics, concrete, and other non-biodegradable materials? Could they be responsible for 50 or even 100% of our medicine? Could we make algae biofuels a reality, replacing the need for non-renewable energy? Or could we harness photosynthesis and generate electricity directly? Maybe in this future, we've harnessed plant-based communication and plants are bioindicators and can replace carbon monoxide monitors or alert us of danger. Or what if plant proteins replace silicon-based systems and we can literally grow our computers? Each plant is an important puzzle piece. Imagine the world we could build once we connect all the pieces. Now, when you walk down the street, the trees illuminate your way. You have plants instead of solar panels on your roof. Living moss walls monitor and filter your air. And a greenhouse in your attic uses your gray water. So let's all take a breath together. We can all breathe better in this future. Thank you.